Okay, good morning and welcome everyone to the 7th meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones and as meeting papers are provided in digital format tablets, you may see members using those during the meeting. That's our general appeal at the start of every meeting, that we promise you that's why you see us looking at our phones and our tablets, okay? So no apologies have been received. Yet again, we have a full house. Good stuff, MSPs. And we move to agenda item two. With agenda item one have been conducted in private shortly before this public session, which is the Local Government Boundary Commission for Scotland's fifth electoral review. The committee will take evidence on Local Government Boundary Commission for Scotland's fifth electoral review and the Scottish Government's subsequent response. And can I welcome this morning Professor Ailsa Henderson, Commissioner, Isabella Drummond Murray, Secretary, and Laura Cregan, Secretariat, Local Government Boundary Commission for Scotland. Can I also welcome Ian Gray for taking the time to come along this morning, Ian Gray MSP, and confirm that I would intend bringing Ian in towards the end of questioning, because he's got some scrutiny questions that he would like to ask. I'll maybe say at this point to members that we've got a fairly tight hour in relation to questioning, so I would be intending and leaving a bit of time at the end, no matter how furiously we're asking questions, to make sure Ian gets a bit of time to come in and ask the questions that he wants to ask. So, good morning. Thank you very much for coming along. We'll get started. Can I invite the Commissioner to make any brief opening remarks, and then we'll follow through questions?
Sure, yeah. Thanks very much for the invitation to be here today. So the Local Government Boundary Commission for Scotland's responsibility is to make recommendations to Scottish ministers and which comply with the statutory requirements placed upon us. The rules under which we work are set out in the Local Government Scotland Act 1973. They require us to identify boundaries that are in the interests of effective and convenient local government. They require us to pay attention to electoral parity above all other things, but subject to that, we have regard to local ties, to easily identifiable boundaries, and to special geographic circumstances. The fifth reviews were the first time councillor numbers and wards had been examined together since the third reviews almost 20 years ago. This is because the fourth reviews, which resulted in the introduction of multi-member wards for STV, didn't revise councillor numbers. So given the changes in population across Scotland and within council areas, changed boundaries were inevitable. Against this background, the Commission considered it right to take a fundamental look at how best to conduct a full review of councillor numbers and wards, and this included examining the methodology that we used. The Commission had consulted previously in 2011 on how councillor numbers might be determined, and the outcomes from that showed support for a consistent Scotland-wide methodology, a call for more equal representation across Scotland, and a call for fewer categories of councils. It also suggested that we continue to use a measure of rurality, but also that we consider the use of deprivation. And we believe that the methodology we've introduced is robust. We've reduced the number of categories from 7 to 5. We've changed the indicators that we use to better reflect indicators currently in use by the Scottish Government. And this includes the proportion of a council's area, a population living in settlements of 3,000 or more, as well as a Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, which is a basket of measures that looks at the socioeconomic but also the geographic circumstances in a council. We've reduced the range of ratios for electors to councillors, making them more equal. We've amended the minimum and maximum council size, so it used to run from 18 to 80, it now runs from 18 to 85. And to minimise disruption, we've implemented a cap on the change in councillor numbers in any council area to 10%. It's a statutory requirement for us to consult with local councils and with the public, and we've done so in two stages, first on councillor numbers and second on ward design. And in terms of our outcomes, we believe there's no single correct way to determine how many councils are needed, either for Scotland as a whole or for a particular council. If we have a statutory duty to consider electoral parity above all else, then we believe that we've fulfilled our statutory responsibilities and that the final outcomes of the reviews deliver an improved electoral position. The reduced range of ratios mean that there's less variation in the value of one vote across Scotland. We have lower levels of deviation from parity in the aggregate, which means representation of the electorate is more evenly shared. And specifically, more wards are within 10% of parity, meaning there's less variation in the value of each vote within a council area. And furthermore, fewer electors will be underrepresented by 10% or more relative to the council average. We believe we've complied with the legislative requirements in both letter and in spirit. We've prioritised parity. We've consulted widely. Indeed, we extended consultation periods where we were able to do so. We've been responsive to the consultation, both with respect to the 2011 consultation on methodology, but also to suggestions to boundaries, and we've made significant changes to those boundaries where we felt that the suggestions of councils and the public have offered us an improvement. In terms of outcomes, we believe we've produced solutions that offer greater equality and less underrepresentation. And of course, we're now happy to take your questions and to follow up in writing as well, if it would be more useful.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Henderson. We'll move to our first question, Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. The question I have is around the cap that you used, the 10% cap for changes. And I'm wondering how you got to that figure as sort of 10% being a magic number that didn't cause disruption or caused minimum disruption in changing.
Sure, yeah, 10% surfaces twice. It's 10% surfaces in the sense that we are using the Venice Commission guide on variation from parity or 10%, and then that separate 10% figure looks at cap. And for us, we felt that given the range of council areas, 10% would get us to whole numbers a lot better. And we were also following best practice in other councils, weren't we? Or in other commissions, weren't we?
Yes, I believe the
Welsh Commission uses 10% as well.
I suppose I just wonder if, you know, we've got examples of where greater changes would have been needed if a sort of figure feels a bit arbitrary. You said it was best practice there. How is it decided that that's the right number?
Well, I think what we wanted to do was minimise disruption. So certainly the 2011 consultation from the public suggested, you know, support for a consistent Scotland-wide methodology. There was no overwhelming call for a significant increase in councillor numbers, but also no overwhelming call for significant disruption in the number of councillors for each specific council area. So the 2011 methodology, or the 2011 consultation on methodology, suggested that if there was a chance for us to minimise disruption, then we should probably take that. And then all the correspondence that we've had with government officials and with the minister suggested that that was the best way to go.
Okay, thank you.
Supplementary, Kenneth Gibson?
Yeah, I mean, Ruth's obviously referring to the North Ayrshire. I actually think that the Boundary Commission proposals in terms of the numbers were better than those put forward by the North Ayrshire Council itself, which has been widely disruptive in terms of my constituency. But one of the things I want to ask is, in terms, you talk about parity, obviously, in your submission. Now, Ruth represents Cunningham South, which under the new proposals will have 17 councillors, and I represent Cunningham North, which will have 16. But I've got 56,000 electors, and Ruth's got about 50,000. So I'll have about 3,500 electors per councillor, whereas Ruth will have just slightly under 3,000. So how does that go with the view that each vote within a local authority area should effectively be in parity? Because what that would suggest, I know that there's deprivation in terms of when you look at councils, you know, per council by council, but within a local authority and you talk about parity, surely there should be the same number of councillors per head within a local authority, and that's certainly not the case in North Ayrshire.
Sure, yeah, I mean, it's a good question, and it's what we tried to do. And I mean, there's a number of ways to look at this. One is to look at it on a Scotland-wide basis. So people living in different parts of Scotland have very different ratios that they're living with. So the value of one vote in Edinburgh is worth about 9 votes in the Western Isles. So there's variation within Scotland already, and some people would already say that's too much variation.
Other way around, sorry.
And so then if you're looking within a council area, we try as best we can to stay as close to parity as possible. But we do use that 10% best practice measure. So we try as best we can to keep the number of electors to councillors the same within a council area. But we do get variation from that. And sometimes that's because we're trying to draw the boundaries, not just strictly on parity, but within the 10%, are there places where we can draw the parity to capture local ties? Are there places where we can draw the boundary so that it's an easily identifiable boundary as well? And we're also allowed to deviate from parity subject to special geographic considerations.
But again, you know, local ties which should be broken by making a particular boundary. I mean, some of the boundaries actually in North Ayrshire just don't make any sense at all. You've got a wee community called Barmill, which is a 40-minute drive from West Kilbride in the same ward. But the other point I was wanting to make was why do you have a situation whereby proportionality varies within local authority areas. I mean, for example, North Ayrshire at the moment has three-member wards and four-member wards. East Renfrewshire, with 20 members, I'd have thought, we just have five four-member wards, but no, it's got two fours and four threes. Now, that makes a significant difference in terms of the election, because a three-member ward, you need 25% plus one to get someone elected. A four-member ward, you only need 20% plus one. So surely, if you're talking about parity within a local authority area, they should all either be three-member wards or all four-member wards. I'm not really sure why you have this disparity in terms of the number of councillors representing a locality, because it does have a significant impact on representation.
Well, presumably that would be true across Scotland as a whole.
Yeah.
I mean, we're given three and four member wards to work with, and so we work with them. And in fact, we've noted that there are instances where having two member wards and having five member wards would have been very helpful to us and able to capture local ties and special geographic circumstances better.
Sorry, I don't. But you've got to work with three or four, so why not make, within a local authority, every ward a four-member ward, or within another local authority, a three-member ward? Why are you varying them between threes and fours in a local authority area, which obviously has an impact?
Well, sometimes we're doing it because it's already a three- and a four-member ward, a mix of three- and four-member wards, and we're trying to minimise change in terms of where the boundaries are, so we're trying to keep them where we can if we need to.
But why did you have them that way in the first place? Surely you would. Surely you.
Why did the previous? Why did the fourth reviews come up with the results that they did?
Surely, when this was set up, you would have wanted much more straightforward, sensible, easily understandable by local people to know that a vote. Because the whole point is about parity, and that a vote in one part of a local authority should mean the same as another, and quite clearly it doesn't when you have differences in terms of number of voters per councillor, and also the ward sizes have either got three or four members, which limits the number of, for example, you could obviously get four parties in a four-member ward, you'll only ever get three in a three-member ward. So what I'm trying to say is, why can you not have parity within a local authority area in terms of ward sizes and representation?
Thanks, and maybe give Professor Henderson just a chance to kind of put her position to the committee, the Boundary Commission's position to the committee in relation to those points.
Sure, yeah. Well, I mean, I certainly can't comment on why the fourth reviews found the results that they did. I mean, mathematically, you can't always have just three-member wards and just four-member wards. But there are times we feel that a mix of three- and four-member wards makes sense because we're trying to use easily identifiable boundaries and we're trying to reflect community ties. When we create boundaries, what we're trying to do is use the boundaries that are already there, the community council boundaries, for example, that are already there, or the previous ward boundaries that are there, or sometimes we look at what the Scottish parliamentary constituency boundaries are, or what the Westminster parliamentary boundaries are. We're trying to use other boundaries that are in place so that we're not just drawing a line that makes no sense to divide up people into equal three and four member chunks. And if we've had any public representation on this, is that we should be paying attention to things like that. We should be paying attention to local ties where we can. And I'm not sure that a bunch of kind of exactly portioned boxes that exactly have the sufficient number for electors to have four councillors throughout a council area is necessarily a solution that would have been well received in all cases.
Okay. Can I just follow up on some of that, Professor Henderson? Because I was looking through some of the criteria and guidelines that you use, and there's inherent contradiction, is there not, between respecting local ties and boundaries and having a arithmetically pure formula which provides parity, or some would say conformity rather than parity. I could cite, but I won't, in relation to my constituency, where there's less co-alignment with Scottish parliamentary constituencies and ward boundaries, but that could then be argued that the new wards better represent actual communities. But there seems to be no black and white in relation to this, and there needs to be a degree of latitude. So if you could say a little bit more about the contradictions that you face in coming to these decisions. But I suppose ultimately what I'm trying to draw out is, does it come down to a judgment call where you could have went, there could be five options in front of you, and two or three of them might be acceptable, but ultimately you just have to opt on one. And what we're trying to get is the methodology behind how you get towards that, and where sometimes you just have to kind of, I don't mean bypass the methodology, but just accept that in certain circumstances there's a compelling argument to ignore parity and go for local ties and boundaries. So to what degree do you find a conflict in coming to any of these decisions?
Mm-hmm. No, I think you're absolutely right. And the tension is in the legislation. So it says we have to pay attention to electoral parity above all else. And so in a way, there is no tension. We have to pay attention to electoral parity. And the only time we can deviate from parity is if there are special geographic circumstances. So the local ties is not there set up in the legislation. It's not set up in tension. It says once you've, you know, having regard for parity, then you can pay attention to easily identifiable boundaries and drawing borders that will not break local ties. However, in practice, I think you're absolutely right that there's a tension between electoral parity and local ties. But the legislation requires us to err on the side of parity. In terms of options, you're absolutely right. We had multiple options for each council area. And when we went out to consultation on ward design, in the first instance to councils, sometimes councils wrote back to us and said, you've selected this option, but actually we think that option better reflects local ties in the area. And we did that in Dundee, for example. So we had an option that we proposed. And in the council consultation, the council said to us, actually, no, this other option you looked at, we think better reflects community ties, better reflects local ties in Dundee. And so that's the version we changed to and went out to public consultation on.
Almost if you knew what the next question was going to be, Professor Henderson, at this point, can I bring in Elaine Smith? I know what's to follow up in terms of how you actually use some of the evidence submissions that you receive, Elaine.
Sure. So thank you very much for joining us this morning. Professor Henderson, I suppose the specific question is, when you made your opening statement, you talked about being responsive to submissions that you received. So specifically, could you tell us about the extent to which, I know you've mentioned councils and maybe you could come on to that, but in particular, the extent to which the public submissions would impact on your conclusions, and could you give us examples of where that would have influenced your conclusions?
Yep. Absolutely. So we had a number, Laura's got the figures in terms of the number of representations that were made by members of the public, but also by different bodies or different individuals. Our reaction to them, in about a quarter of cases, I think we made changes, and we made them in two different ways. It was a quarter of cases on councillor numbers. There were more instances in terms of ward design. The reactions the changes that we made were largely in two categories. One, it was people calling for their community to be within a local, within a single ward. So that was an instance of, say, Collington in Edinburgh, but also Houston in Renfrewshire and Bridge of Allen. So people there wanted their community to be represented in a single ward, even if that meant they would have fewer councillors than otherwise would be the case. And then the other change we made was when electors in communities wanted to be paired with another community. So around Hoyk, for example, we made changes with Newcastleton. There was a change around Cawdor as well, Nairn Cawdor. So we were responding to public demand and trying to make these two changes. I think it's worth noting that we did get contradictory advice. So on the one hand, while we got in some communities a desire to put communities all within a single ward, in other instances, we got people from communities saying, we don't want to be in a single ward. We would like our community to be divided, even if it means that we're connected with other communities on either side, because we think that will mean we will have more councillors keeping an eye on the area. And so that was an instance with Hoyk, but it was also the case with Musselburgh. So we were getting representations arguing for completely the opposite thing. Some people who want to be together in a smaller ward, some people who want to be separated out in divided wards with more representation. And so we just tried to do what we could. And if we found a way to make it work, we did.
And so further to that, was it important then, the responses you got from councils, and were those responses timely for you? And what information did they give to assist you with some of this?
No, absolutely. We had representation from councils on councillor numbers, but also on ward design. And we did make changes. I mentioned Dundee earlier, but we also had the case in the Scottish Borders where we had an option that we put to them on ward design, and they said, you know what, actually we think we can do a better job. So they took 4 days and they drafted something and they brought it to us, and the solution seemed to be a good one, and we believed that they were able to create a design that better reflected local ties given their knowledge. And so that's the version we went out to on public consultation. So we've got evidence of how we've changed our proposals on councillor numbers, but also on ward design following the consultation with the councils, but then again following the consultation with the public.
And so just further to that then, I mean, obviously you talk a lot about the numbers and the consultation and the design and communities, whether they're naturally kept together. But could you tell us a wee bit about the measures of deprivation that you used as well and how that impacted?
Sure. Yep. So we used two measures to categorise councils. And in the previous reviews, the two measures to categorise councils were both measures of rurality. One was about population distribution and the other one was density. And we felt that those two were measuring pretty much the same thing. And so in the consultation in 2011, certainly there was continued support for the notion of categorising councillors, but also a call for us to think about the measures that we were using, and deprivation was used. And we were looking also at other bodies at the time that were also creating categories of councils. And so we were looking at the SLARC research, the Remuneration Committee research, on how it was banding councils, and it was using the Scottish Index for multiple deprivation. So it's perhaps unfortunately named, because it leads people to believe that it's a measure of poverty, but it isn't. It's a basket of measures that capture not just people who are living on particular incomes or people who are on incapacity and different forms of benefit, but it also looks at school enrollment population. It looks at the proportion of people living in a particular zone in higher education. It looks at crime rates. But critically for us, it also looks at public access. So it looks at transport times made by car to different services and the shops and amenities. And it looks at public transport times in terms of access to schools and shops and public services. And so the SIMD deprivation index isn't a measure of poverty, as has often been assumed. It captures a range of socioeconomic and geographic circumstances in a local area. And we believed that because it was a measure that was also being used frequently by the Scottish Government and critically had been used by another body that was also banding councils, that it was a useful one to use.
Thanks. Okay, thank you. Alexander Stewart.
Can I just declare an interest as a serving member of Perth and Kinross Council? Just following on from that, Professor, we understand that, you know, the consultation process was quite lengthy. You wanted to try and engage with as many individual councils, organisations, community groups as you could. And I think that very much did take place, especially with the number of councils and the ward designs that you talked about. You decided to extend some of the consultation on some areas because it was obviously so successful. Were there areas that were unsuccessful that you felt you could learn from the process, because some council areas were much more engaged than others? Was that because they were much more active, or they took a bigger interest, or... Because there seems to be quite a difference across the country geographically about how people got involved. You know, in some areas there were small meetings, in other areas there were town halls full of people making representation. And how you managed that process and how successful you felt that process was to ensure that you had that public consultation and that engagement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's a great question. And one thing we're going to be doing at... is having a look at the fifth reviews and looking at how things have gone, both from the methodology perspective and from the public consultation perspective, so that we can write up what we think our best practice is, so that the people conducting the next reviews have something to work with. In terms of the public consultation, I mean, we tried as best we could to create a system where you were not disadvantaged in terms of participating if, for example, you were not online readily. So we were sending information out to information points. And we did do a kind of survey ourselves in terms of how frequently those pieces of information were, in fact, displayed. It was a bit patchy, I have to say. And then we created an online portal that allowed people to comment on the ward design. And it was... I mean, it's an incredible piece. We're using it again for the Boundary Commission for Scotland in the Westminster boundaries. You can highlight an area. You can redraw a boundary yourself. You can highlight points where you think it might work better or worse. So we've tried to use kind of low tech and high tech methods to engage as much of the population as possible. I think you're absolutely right that participation was not even across the council areas. So we had, you know, over 800 responses in some cases. There is not necessarily a relationship, I think, between the number of responses and the number of serious concerns. Because what we did find is that there was a lot of miscommunication, and I think we do have to reflect on how we communicate what the boundaries mean. So we did have people saying, you can't put the boundary there because it means I'll have to send my children to a different school, it will change my postcode, it will change my house value, it will change where I buy my, you know, where I go for my messages, and none of that is true. And so I think we do have a task in terms of improving our communication so that we make clear what the consequences of certain boundaries are. But certainly that is exactly something that we're going to be looking at when we look back on the process.
Thank you, convener.
Can I maybe, is it specific on consultation? Because I was going to ask another question on consultation. If it's on that, I'll take you in first, Mr. Simpson.
It's actually to do with subjects that have been covered. I wanted to come back in on the deprivation.
Right. Well, maybe we'll come back on that. We'll just maybe finish exploring consultation. I'll take you back in on deprivation, Mr. Simpson. Sorry about that. So in terms of consultation, you could argue that this committee is now performing a scrutiny role to the end point of this process. Now, I'm not saying we should be a statutory consultees. In fact, we've only been on this committee for a number of months, but the process did start back in 2014. There was a previous local government committee who would have had the option to scrutinise or work in partnership at the start of the process. I'm just wondering, is there a backstory there that we should be aware of about representations from the previous local government committee or representations that the Boundary Commission for Scotland made to them?
Not so long as I've been a member, but that's only since October 2013.
I'm not aware of any previous engagement.
And the process started in 2014?
The formal start of the review. The current commissioners were all appointed towards the end of 2013.
Okay. I won't dwell on this point because there was much of a responsibility for the predecessor local government committee if they sought to do a piece of work on this as there is for this committee. But I'm conscious this committee is scrutinising the end point of a process. Do you think it'd be worthwhile in the future having whatever subject committee had the remit in relation to local government to be scrutinising at the start of a process? And would that be helpful in terms of public awareness and understanding?
Certainly improved, enhanced communication would be very welcome. Yeah.
I think in explaining the approach, it might be very helpful. Of course, we would remember our independence from political considerations that might be of interest to you that aren't things we would be taking account of at that time. But clearly, yes, explaining our approach and having those discussions, it would always be helpful.
I think that's really helpful that you actually mentioned the concept of political considerations, and the role of this committee today is to examine the process and the robustness of that process rather than necessarily have any political considerations within that. But in terms of that process, and I'll move to Mr. Simpson in a second, it's an opportunity perhaps to respond just once further to this. It's like scrutinising an end point where a process has run for 2 years. Do you think there's a role, not as part of a politicised process, but in terms of a political accountability and scrutiny process, for a subject committee such as this to be in at the ground floor of scrutinising the remit that you're under, the initial approach that the Boundary Commission for Scotland is taking, and if the committee was to have any concerns, helping, given that there is strict independence, perhaps making any concerns that may be flagged up with us in relation to that at the start of the process, rather than waiting to an end of a process and saying, well, here's what you should have done better.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I take Isabel's point that we wouldn't necessarily be able to make changes, but certainly the opportunity to discuss our methodology and to explain what we're trying to do, and also to emphasise the rules under which we work and how we are, an opportunity to explain the logic of our decision making would have been very helpful. And I think sometimes we did find when we went out and we visited all 32 councils, and there was a bit of misunderstanding about what we were trying to do and what the measures were as well, even though we would explain, that we're using this very particular measure. I think there were a number of misconceptions about what we were trying to do and what we were doing.
I think that's something that we might return to, that you are duty bound in statute to have a very clear remit, and that remit's independent, and that process has to be allowed to run, and where political representatives can make appropriate representations and scrutiny, and indeed checks and balances in the system, and no doubt that's something that we'll return to in the future, but I think it is one of the issues that we'll have to wrestle with as a committee, so thank you for that answer. Mr. Simpson, my apologies for not taking you in sooner. Graham Simpson.
No problem, convener. I'll probably come back to what you've just been touched on there. Can I just ask about this deprivation measure, because I'm not really clear where it's come from. Was it your idea?
No. Deprivation or SIMD in particular?
To use the deprivation measure in deciding how many councillors should be in a particular council or a particular ward.
In terms of the categories, no. I mean, the 2011 consultation was on methodology. And so the first discussion, as far as I understand it, the first discussion of deprivation surfaced then in 2011, in part because the two indicators we had been using to categorise councils before were measuring the same thing. They were both measures of rurality. And so this was seen as a way of capturing not just rurality, which is relevant, but also the socioeconomic and other geographic circumstances of a council.
Sorry, I'm so confused as to where it's come from and why it's there, why it was used as a measure.
Well, we need to categorise councils. We can't have all councils with the same ratio of electors to councils, because it would mean that you would have to radically change the council sizes in the different local areas. So you would end up with very tiny councils in Western Isles and very large ones in the larger ones.
Sorry,
and so because
you misunderstand. You've used deprivation as a measure to decide numbers.
No, we've used deprivation as a measure to categorise councils. So I'm explaining why we're categorising councils to begin with, because some people would say, why bother? So we've categorised councils, and in 2011 the consultation said, why don't you think about deprivation, but also why don't you reduce the number of categories, because there's too many. So we've reduced the number of categories from 7 to 5, and we've used two measures to categorise councillors. But those measures are not strictly determining the councillor numbers. The ratios determine the councillor numbers, and the population in a local area determines the council numbers. SIMD data and the proportion of the population living in settlements of 3,000 or smaller, those are the measures that we use to categorise the councils, to create councils that are broadly in similar circumstances. So you have very urban ones that have higher levels of deprivation, and you have very rural ones that have lower levels of deprivation, for example, and you have different categories of councils that are broadly similar. And so those councils that have broadly similar characteristics share a ratio in terms of the number of electors to each councillor.
So a council in a particular category would get the same
exactly
kind of ratio. So you actually have used it because
but
you've categorised it.
And we wanted to know what the impact of deprivation was. So we ran the methodology in a number of different ways. So I looked at it and I ran it. Let's assume that we use the old categories. Let's assume that we use the old indicators of density and distribution, and we just updated the ratios, because we were always going to have to update the ratios because the number of councillors stayed the same, but the population has increased. So if we had done that, and we calculated the numbers for that, and then we calculated the numbers for what would happen in our new way of categorising things, and what we find is that in 16 of the 32 councils, the introduction of the new indicator, the introduction of SIMD data, has absolutely no impact on councillor numbers at all. You would have had exactly the same number of councillors had you just used an updated ratio, but kept the old way of categorising things.
Okay. In terms of feedback that you got from councils, what would you say was the proportion in which you changed the initial recommendations as a result of that feedback?
It was at which stage? At the first stage it was 7, wasn't it?
We changed councillor numbers when we started to consider the ward boundary implications of certain councillor numbers. So there was nothing set in stone as a result of the methodology per se. It was when we started to look at, you know, what are the distribution of communities, etc., and how we could take them on board. And in some cases, we had to change councillor numbers to get a better result in effect.
And that was in 7 councils.
We changed councillor numbers in 7 areas.
So as a result of feedback from 7 councils, you changed your recommendations?
No, as when it came to ward design, what we found is that sometimes the numbers that we had proposed just didn't work. You end up with wards that are a strange shape, or you end up with wards that you have a leftover ward that has too many people in it. And so what we find is that sometimes we have to increase the number of councillors by one.
Right. You mentioned Dundee, and they came back with proposals. Did you accept them?
There's two things. One is we came up with our option, and the council said, we prefer your other option. So we did adopt that one. We said, okay, fine, you like that one. We'll go out to public consultation on that one. So we did make a change on that. In response to the public consultation, there was concern from primarily West Ferry that it was no longer with Broughty Ferry. But the problem with multi-member wards is if you have an area that is probably worth about six councillors, you can't make that a single ward. You have to divide it. And so what we did was we had a four-member ward in Broughty Ferry, and we put the boundary over as far as we could, and the people in West Ferry were then put in a boundary with those in East Dundee. So we had calls to change it, but we couldn't create a six or a seven-member ward.
Right, but you accepted the recommendations from the council.
Yeah.
So that then leads into what the convener was asking about, because the minister rejected those final proposals.
Yes.
And some people could argue, well, that was political interference. But what's your view of that?
Well, the minister has that authority to accept, reject, or modify proposals, and so it hasn't ever been done before. But it is within the minister's authority, and so in that respect, I suppose we can't be surprised if someone uses the authority that they have. With respect to the islands, I suppose we weren't particularly concerned because it was in the SNP manifesto that an islands bill would be coming. And so we I suppose, would have seen that coming, perhaps.
So what with respect to what the convener was saying, it's a final point.
The line of questioning you're about to explore, we agreed that Mr. Whiteman was going to look at the start of the session, which is how we move from Boundary Commission recommendations onto ministerial approval of otherwise. So give you a degree of latitude that other members are specifically going to be raising this point in a structured fashion.
Final point, convener, and then it might lead to Mr. Whiteman.
It will do, so make a point.
That's fine. So could we have a system where the final check is not a political check but an independent check?
Well, certainly there are other ways of doing things. There are other ways of approving boundaries. With the administrative reviews that the local government boundary commission conducts, the minister can also accept, reject, or amend. But with the Scottish Parliament boundaries, the minister has no power to direct the commission to make any changes. And the same is true for Westminster boundaries. There's also an affirmative resolution procedure rather than a negative resolution procedure. So what's distinct here is not just ministerial role, but also the relative absence of a parliamentary role, I would say.
And that's absolutely something that this committee will explore. And just be careful in our use of language, because the relevant minister will be giving evidence to this committee in a few weeks' time. And I think any suggestions of a political role are best placed to that minister. But it's reasonable to put on the record that the position was made as a government minister rather than as a party political one.
Yeah,
but we can explore that with the minister when they give evidence. And we have to look at whether there's an appropriateness in terms of the process that exists. But that is the process that currently exists, mm-hmm. which I know Mr. Whiteman wishes to explore further. Mr. Whiteman, thank you for your patience.
Thank you, convener. You're required to review these boundaries every 8 to 12 years, and we've been doing this process largely unchanged since 1889. Do you have a view on whether the public can still have confidence in this process, given that the final decision is in the hands of a politician and that there is no parliamentary role for determining the final boundaries? And the second question related to that is about the timetable for your review and the knock-on consequences for the ministerial decision in relation to that review. And there have been concerns expressed that your reporting in May 2016, the decision being made by the minister in September 2016, was just a little bit too close to the May 2017 elections, given the sometimes complex processes that political parties have to go through to select candidates, which in multi-member wards and all the rest of it can take a little bit of time. So the second question is about the timetable and are there any improvements that could be made there?
Mm-hmm. Well, in terms of public confidence, I think there's a number of things to point out. One is our independence. So we work within the statutory framework that we are given, and we followed it very, very closely. So from that perspective, I think absolutely the public can have confidence in the reviews. In terms of whether they can have confidence in the judgment of a Scottish minister, well, I would assume that would be the case of any policy decision. I don't know why it would be any different for this one. So in terms of timetable improvements, yeah, I think you're absolutely right. And certainly there is no time for us to conduct another review, save on in Dundee or in Scottish Borders or Aygaill and Bute, in time for the 2017 elections. It's not quite as much of a surprise, given that we have been we put our ward design proposals out very, very early. And so while we have made some modifications that would have given political parties some idea of what the landscape would have been like for the 2017 elections, but I take your point that it could be earlier.
Just on my first question, I wasn't suggesting that the public may not have confidence in the boundary commission. I was questioning whether the public can have confidence in the process as a whole when you make properly independent recommendations, but the final decision, and this relates to people's communities and where they live, the final decision is in the hands of a politician, elected politician, but Parliament does not have a role in determining the final look of the boundaries. So, I mean, you may not have a view on that because we've been doing this for 100 years or more, but I'm just sort of flagging it up as possibly needing change, particularly in the light of your comments that you made in relation to to the statutory framework around the Scottish Parliament and the Westminster Parliament elections.
Yeah, well, it could well be something worth exploring, in part because the position of the Local Government Boundary Commission is about to change, in that we used to just deal with the boundaries for local government elections, and the Boundary Commission for Scotland used to deal with the boundaries for Westminster and Holyrood. But following the Smith Commission recommendations and the Act, we will now also be looking at the boundaries for Holyrood. But there's a very different process in terms of how those recommendations are approved. The Minister has no role in terms of amending any boundaries we propose for Holyrood elections, and there is a parliamentary role. So it might well be the case that there is a desire to at least make it so that the process for the Boundary Commission by which Boundary Commission decisions are approved is the same, regardless of whether you're looking at local government boundaries or Scottish Parliament boundaries. But which you choose is up to you, really.
Thank you.
Can we perhaps explore that a little bit further and actually take Mr. Gibson first, and then myself and Mr. Simpson perhaps come in to explore that a bit further, and then I think move to Mr. Gray because he's got some questions he'd like to ask Mr. Gibson.
Well, I was just going to ask a wee bit about flexibility, convener, if that's okay, because I was talking about local authorities on four or three member wards throughout, but there's another thing's obviously come up, which is an anomaly whereby some communities feel completely detached from the other part of their ward. So, for example, my own constituency, the Isle of Arran, 10 miles off the coast, is attached to Ardrossan, and neither community feels that that's a happy arrangement, but clearly under the legislation, they have to be fitted into a three or four member ward. Do you think there should be more flexibility in legislation in terms of maybe having one, two, or five member wards possibly? Is there a role for that for communities such as that? Not just that, but there'll be other communities around Scotland in a similar situation, I would believe.
No, that's a good question, and we made a point of noting in our discussions where we felt that actually the ability to just use three and four member wards maybe prevented us from having a better solution that managed to balance parity and local ties. So we were focusing not on single member wards because we were thinking within the framework of STV, of multi-member wards. We were thinking about instances where, say, a two-member ward and a five-member ward might be more helpful. And specifically, we were thinking that would be helpful in Perth and Kinross, but also in the Scottish Borders, in Western Isles, in North Ayrshire, but also in Argyll and Bute.
Yes, because I mean, what happens in a situation like that is you have a de facto single member ward. The councillor of whichever party, and it's been three parties and an independent in the last four elections, whoever actually resides on the island effectively represents the island, and the mainland councillors don't take any interest, and vice versa. So you do effectively have that situation. In any case, and it would be better if it was authorised. But just my final point, convener, when we talked about parity, and I talked about the fact that my constituency will have 16 and Ruth's 17 councillors, and there's a 3,500 electors per councillor in mine and 3,000 hers. You talked about the fact that you're only really looking at a 10% change and don't want to be disruptive. But the fourth review was the first to look at proportional representation, multi-member wards. So surely if those wards were not actually constructed appropriately, should we not kind of go back more or less to first principles rather than build on what effectively wasn't done perhaps properly in the first place in order to ensure that the parity, which is so important in the legislation, is carried through? Because I don't really think that that's happened in certainly in my neck of the woods, and I'm sure it must be the case in other parts of Scotland.
Sure. I mean, I think there's another tension there in terms of an ideal solution. I don't think there's one ideal solution, and also disruption. So we have some councils that have used the wards that were created in the fourth reviews as the basis for economic committees or regeneration committees in their area. And so if we draw them in radically different places, from one review to the next, then we can introduce disruption that I think local councils wouldn't necessarily find helpful.
Our legislation requires parities, number of electors per council. We didn't really look at proportionality in the way you're describing. Mm-hmm. I mean, the legislation doesn't require us to do that. Mm-hmm. So again, it just comes back to the hierarchy of bits within Schedule 6 of the Act, and that puts parity, and it doesn't define proportionality as something we should look at.
But the point I've been making is there is no parity in my own local authority area because the weighting is towards the south of the authority rather than throughout.
Maybe you'll leave that set, Mr. Gibson. Indeed. Just for time constraints, I think both myself and Mr. Simpson, who will give the opportunity to come back in, will both have to be brief. I want to return just to the process and the end point of the process again in relation to ministerial decision in relation to the Boundary Commission's recommendations. There seems to be a conflict again in relation to this, where if a minister accepts every recommendation, it could be seen to rubber stamp. If it doesn't accept every recommendation, it could be seen to interfere. And there's a tension that sits between those two compass points, if you like. So I suppose I'm asking about whether you believe there should be a check and balance in the system, because under statute at the moment, the check and balance in the system is ministers having to approve that process. And if we did move away and change the rules and the regulations in relation to that, do you have any views on how we should move away from that? And I'm just minded that some of the suggestions that have been made, and we will explore those suggestions, might actually lead to even more politicians having a say about their own local areas in a politicised fashion. So how do we move away, if we should indeed move away from the current process that depoliticises it and doesn't lead to even more conflicts?
Yeah, I suppose it's two different issues. One is about the ability to accept or reject, and the other is the ability to amend. The ability to choose which are... These are 32 separate reviews, so in a way the minister has 32 decisions to make. So the only tension, I suppose, for us is that we have created a methodology that offers a Scotland-wide approach and seeks to create a solution that works best, not only within a council area, but for Scotland as a whole. We have attempted to make representation more equal for Scotland as a whole. We've reduced the range of ratios that are used. We have attempted to reduce the deviation from parity that occurs within council areas. And so, by not accepting five of those recommendations, some of the improvements that we've made will not have been realised. So the ratios are not as compressed as they would have been otherwise. The deviation from parity is not as small as it would have been otherwise. And there are also challenges about remaining with boundaries from the fourth review in those five areas where the recommendations were not accepted. So the Isle of Bute, for example, has 5,000 people, just over 5,000 people, and it has three councillors. Well, Merrifield and Dundee has three councillors, and it has 12,000 electors. So those kinds of disparity would not occur had all 32 been accepted.
That kind of was not the question. The question was about whether there should be a check and balance in the system from the 32 recommendations that the Boundary Commission makes. And of course, the Boundary Commission is going to support all 32 recommendations that it makes. But if there is a check, well, there is a check and balance in the system, and that's ministerial decision about whether to accept or otherwise those 32 decisions. If they accept the 32 decisions every single time, then the work of the Boundary Commission has been perfect since its inception. And as much as it's an esteemed organisation, every organisation might not always get it quite right. The issue is whether or not the check and balance should sit at a ministerial level, whether you're content with that, or what the alternative should be in a way that doesn't even, perhaps, in theory, politicise it.
I mean, I don't think it's for me to comment on what the approval process for our recommendations should be. I'm merely trying to point out that our recommendations attempt to get the best solution for Scotland as a whole. And so therefore, by going with old boundaries that are using old data, there are certain costs to that.
I wasn't trying to tease it whether there should be a check and balance in the system.
It's for others to judge, but I think Ailsa's point earlier that if we were sitting here as a commission talking about changes to council area boundaries, there would be a negative resolution procedure in the parliament. So there is a different system, but I think consideration of which is better or worse isn't for us to make that decision.
And I think that's a very strong point that we'll definitely return to. I was just trying to tease out whether there was a position on that. My apology, I wasn't as brief as I should have been, Mr. Simpson, and then Mr. Gray, I promise you'll come in after that. Do you want to add anything, Mr. Simpson?
Well, not really. I think it's not fair to ask your opinion on this, but it's something we should certainly explore later.
Absolutely, we will do. Ian, my apologies.
No, at all.
You've got about 5 minutes or so.
Okay, thanks, Convener. I have two questions, and they're both very specifically about East Lothian, which I represent. But I will try to couch them in terms of the efficacy of the methodology. East Lothian is the fastest growing county in the whole of Scotland in the last decade. Its population has grown by 11% and is projected to grow by almost 25% in the next 25 years. But the Commission's recommendation reduces the number of councillors that we have to represent that population. That just seems to fly in the face of all common sense and reduce democratic accountability rather than enhance it. Surely that's a failure of the process.
Well, I think if we weren't, I don't think it's a failure of the process. I think there are different ways to do this. And one way would be to just take whatever the population of the council area is and to work out the number of councillors based on that. But we can't do that, really, and end up with council sizes that are councillor numbers for each local authority area that are of sufficient size. They would be too small in certain cases and too large in others. We would end up with a Glasgow council that would have 166 members if we did something like, if we just used population. So we have to categorise them to look at councils that are in that are facing certain common circumstances. And so we looked at, well, what puts pressure on councillors? What helps helps them? What makes their workload harder or less hard? And we kept a measure of rurality because we understand that that does make a difference. And we adopted a measure that we think captures other pressures that councillors face in their workload. And we use that to categorise the councils. We can't just look at population because we would end up with council sizes that are far away from the 18 to 85 limit with which we work.
But population growth in East Lothian isn't marginal. It's the greatest in the whole of Scotland. And I'm not suggesting our number of councillors should be increased. I'm asking why they should, in those circumstances, be reduced. This part of Scotland is not at the margins of population growth. It's the fastest growing area in the whole country.
I think Ailsa's point was Scotland-wide methodology that resulted in proposals for councillor numbers in East Lothian. Population growth
will
be
respect,
taken into account.
The Professor just said there were 32 separate reviews.
But there is a consistent methodology. I mean, it isn't that nobody's ever argued to us that there shouldn't be a consistent Scotland-wide methodology. It isn't what happens in England. There are other ways of doing it, but we do have that consistent methodology.
Can I ask them what's the factor which has reduced democratic accountability in East Lothian? If it's not based on population, which manifestly isn't, what is the consistent factor which has led to a reduction in our number of councillors?
Well, it's not based on population, because it can't be based on population alone, because as I said, you would end up with markedly different council size, unworkable council sizes that don't. That don't reflect the number of councils. And so therefore in creating these categories, we have used two indicators. We have used a measure of rurality, and we have used a measure that captures the socioeconomic and geographic circumstances of a council, the SIMD data. So it's those two together.
So the reduction is based on
categorizing
the SIMD
councils.
Categorization.
No, well, not on its own.
It can't be based on population or rurality, because we do have a rurality factor and population's growing, so
It wouldn't be one on its own. It would be both together, and it's not based on population. Still has a role. Population still has a role, because that's where the ratios come in. Mm. So if you have two councils in the same category that have similar socioeconomic circumstances, similar geographic circumstances, but one is smaller than the other, you will end up with the larger area having more councillors.
Okay, can I just ask one other question, convener? We've also talked about the ward design, so having set the number of councillors, the ward design, and again in East Lothian, ward design in three out of the seven wards in the council really drives the coach and horses through those historic community and geographical links that you've talked about. It cuts across school catchment boundaries, Scottish Parliament boundaries, and those designs were not supported by the council, by community councils, by any of the political parties, or by any other political representatives, including myself. So if three out of seven wards have little or no support in terms of their design, is that not also surely a failure in the consultation process?
Yeah, I don't know if we could say that it has little or no support. What we found is that we had limited public engagement with ward design, even in those areas where there was concern, like in West Ferry and Dundee and in Colinton, for example, in Edinburgh and in Houston. We did not get overwhelming support that would suggest the majority of respondents in an area or the majority of electors in an area were engaged with the issue and were aware of the issue. So we did get expressions of concern, but fundamentally, sometimes that expression of concern is not with the ward, but with the existence of multi-member wards. Sometimes it's actually that what people want is a single-member ward. But there's nothing we can do about that.
But in the examples that we're talking about, the specific wards in East Lothian, it's exactly about the relationship between villages and towns, for example. It's exactly about the relationship with other boundaries, such as school catchments, Scottish Parliament boundaries. That was the basis of the submissions that were made from, for example, the local authority, for example, from myself.
Mm-hmm.
But nonetheless, there's been no change to that.
Just to indicate, because of time constraints, my apologies, Mr. Gray, this the last comment and we'll have to move on.
Let's just very briefly say, of course, we did make changes. We increased council numbers from the methodology by one in East Lothian, precisely to try and keep Trinent and McMurray in a ward, and we did do that. It just becomes, basically, I think, in a way, you're advocating no change, because we wouldn't, if we always had to stick with a council's existing planning designations, school catchments, we wouldn't have a role, because there'd be nothing for us to actually look at in determining parity. So, you know, we've described the process we've gone through, but of course we did move away from the methodology to give East Lothian an extra councillor.
And I noticed that we will want to apply that. My apologies that we don't have time to do that. Can I thank all our witnesses this morning for what I thought was a really useful evidence session, and Mr. Gray to come along participating in the work of the committee as well. And can we suspend briefly before we move to the next agenda item? Thank you. Okay, good morning and welcome back to Local Government Community Committee's meeting. We move back into public session and we move to Agenda Item 3, Subordinate Legislation. The committee will take evidence on the draft Council Tax Substitution of Proportion Scotland Order 2016 and the draft Council Tax Variation for Unoccupied Dwellings Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016. And can I welcome to the committee Derek Mackay, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution, Robin Haynes, Council Tax and CTR Reform Branch, and Stuart Fubister, Solicitor, Scottish Government. The instruments that I've just outlined are laid under affirmative procedures, which means the Parliament must approve them before the provisions can come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited the next two agenda items to consider motions to approve the instruments. Before we move to questions, can I welcome our three witnesses again and invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for inviting me to your evidence session today. I'd like to begin by saying a few words about the perhaps less debated of the two draft statutory instruments under consideration today, that applying to second homes. As the explanatory notes describe, under the present legislation, a council may grant a discount of between 10 and 50% of normal council tax liability in respect of a second home. This draft instrument seeks to extend this flexibility to allow a council to also decide to grant no discount in respect of second homes, in other words, to charge the full council tax on second homes. In this context, a second home is defined as a dwelling that is furnished and lived in for at least 25 days in any 12-month period, but not as someone's sole or main residence. So it's distinct from, for example, dwellings that have been unoccupied for over 12 months and for which separate legislation continues to apply unchanged. Importantly, these regulations do not seek to alter the treatment of properties where the owner or tenant is required by their job to live elsewhere, for example, members of the armed forces living in barracks. There are over 27,000 properties defined as second homes in Scotland. If enacted, these regulations would give councils additional flexibility and autonomy to address local circumstances, whilst potentially raising an estimated of £3 million. I will now turn to the Council Tax Substitution of Proportion Scotland Order 2016. This seeks to do one thing only, to increase the amounts of council tax payable for properties in bands E, F, G and H, by 7.5%, 12.5%, 17.5% and 22.5% respectively. This change would affect just over a quarter of all households in Scotland and have no impact on the 1.8 million or so properties in bands A to D. The change is set out in Regulation 2 of the draft statutory instrument. It would make council tax more proportionate. Indeed, the Independent Resolution Foundation in a report of April this year stated that these proposals would increase the proportionality of council tax. So the question being put to the committee, and indeed to Parliament, in considering this order, is whether we want council tax to be more proportionate by requiring those in bands E to H properties to pay slightly more. If these new multipliers were implemented with the present rates of council tax, charges for affected properties would still, on average, remain less than the equivalent in England, or if there had been no council tax freeze. The measure will raise an additional £500 million over the period of the current Parliament. It is, of course, not the only change proposed by the Scottish Government. There are other measures that the committee has received representations on, and some of those relate to regulations that amend Council Tax Reduction Scheme and are presently under consideration by the Social Security Committee. Other changes are non-legislative or can be delivered within existing powers. I note that the committee has taken evidence on a number of issues beyond the subject of this order, including a lively discussion last week on how the changes might be communicated to households. However, the resolution of many of these points is something that will be achieved through dialogue and agreement between, in the main, Scottish Government, COSLA, and Local Government Revenue and Benefits Practitioner Community. These changes can be implemented in April 2017. Wider change, as some of the evidence to the committee confirms, cannot be delivered in that time frame for either administrative or legislative reasons. For example, the powers under which this order are made do not extend to such issues as notification to taxpayers or funding to councils to implement the changes but the powers do allow ministers to amend the proportions that determine the council tax charged on all dwellings in relation to Band D charge set by councils. So the key question to consider today is, when assessing whether this order should be approved, is whether we want to make council tax more proportionate by requiring those in properties in bands E to H to pay relatively more.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Now, I suspect we'll have a number of questions in relation to the statute instrument in relation to council tax substitution of proportion Scotland Order 2016, but I've had an indication that there might be one or two questions briefly in relation to the other order. So I'll call Elaine Smith and then we'll take Graeme Simpson after that.
Thanks very much, and thanks for joining us this morning, Cabinet Secretary. On the draft council tax variation for unoccupied dwellings order, which you mentioned first and when you opened, could I just clarify then that what this does is recognise the importance of local decision making and the changes that are being made?
I suppose it's a fair question in that it recognises it's giving councils the flexibility, yes.
Thanks, thank you. Just want to clarify that.
Okay, and a theme may be emerging here, Cabinet Secretary, I suspect. I'm sure we'll have a lively discussion. Can I remind members on their hands how many questions we ask, but we also have a significant time period should members wish to use it for a debate, to debate each statutory instrument as well. So just remind members of that also. Graeme Simpson.
Well, thanks for coming, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. The change that you're proposing to council tax has been linked to the attainment fund. Now, which came first? Was it the idea of the attainment fund and how to fund that, or was it a desire to reform council tax?
I think, thanks, Convener. I suppose that's more of a difficult question for me to answer, in that I wasn't the Cabinet Secretary at the time when the statement was given around the council tax approach, and then went into the preparation of the manifesto, which is presented to the public. But the First Minister outlined our response to local taxation earlier in the year. So I think both are important to government, reforming local taxation and, of course, education and targeting resources to attainment and tackling the gap that exists.
I'm right in saying, though, that money raised from council tax, and I know you'll say that councils will keep all that money, but you'll reduce the grant, you'll get the money back. That money will be used for the attainment fund.
Well, Mr. I answered the last question as accurately as I possibly could, and I'll do so with this question around the resource. So what Mr. Simpson is asking about is how the revenue would be raised. So these multipliers generate more money for local government. It's in the knowledge of that that you can then make other decisions around the wise use of resources. But it does remain the case that every single penny raised by council tax, including the multipliers, will stay with each local authority. And the method of local government funding and distribution is a matter that is agreed with the local authorities. I was previously on the distribution and settlement group within local government. That was an interesting and challenging experience, but it does remain the case that every penny raised in council tax will stay with those local authorities, and any further mechanism will be through the budget and the revenue support grant, as has previously been explained in the chamber.
Upon that, I'll just note that I've had bids for supplementaries from Mr. Gibson and Mr. Stewart, if you want to follow up on that a bit further.
Yes, absolutely. So a lot of the evidence that we've had as a committee is around the question of local accountability. Essentially, this policy is being introduced to raise money for a national priority. And there's great concern around that in local government. And that's reflected in the evidence that we've had. How do you answer that?
Well, I think some people have, you know, suggested that we're clawing council tax money away from councils. We're not. Local authorities keep every penny raised through council tax, and that includes through the multipliers. But what we're able to do through the revenue support grant, how the government distributes the money, and, you know, similar to the business rates scheme, we adapt the arrangements for how we allocate additional resources to local authorities, and that's how we can address this issue, ensuring that there's resources for education, and that's a matter of discussion with local government. But council tax monies stay with councils, what we'll discuss in targeting the attainment fund is around revenue support.
Final question before we take in three bids for supplementaries on this theme. Mr. Simpson, do you want to add on to that?
If that's okay, convener.
Yes, of course.
I think you're trying to dodge the issue, and you know exactly what I'm asking. You're going to take the money back in grants to fund a national priority, so that that breaks that local accountability. Council tax bills rise to fund your priority. You're entitled to have priorities, whatever they are, but you're funding your priority essentially from a cut in revenue grant as a result of increasing council tax.
Mr. Simpson accuses me of dodging the question. I would argue you're dodging the answer, which is to say that local authorities will keep every penny of council tax that they raise, every penny. So that's extra resource to local authority arising from the change to multipliers that we are proposing. But there is an already well-established system of redistribution and distribution of resources which comes through local government finance orders, which comes through negotiation with the local authorities, and how that's distributed on a needs basis. That infrastructure is already very well established within the world of local government that Mr. Simpson knows very well. And I just say again that the monies that are derived from any multiplier change stays within the council tax pot. They have that accountability.
Simpson will have the opportunity to add to his thoughts on that during the debate, should he wish to take the opportunity. But I think you've had a fair airing there, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's just to tease us out a wee bit more. I mean, if we look at the figures from Spice, East Renfrewshire will raise an extra £4 million. North Ayrshire, which I represent, £1.9 million. But it could be argued that in terms of meeting the attainment gap, East Renfrewshire having the highest attainment in Scotland, it might not need £4 million, whereas North Ayrshire may need significantly more than £1.9 million. So what you're saying is that the money that's raised through council tax will stay there. So East Renfrewshire will clearly keep its £4 million. But if North Ayrshire Council is to have more than the £1.9 million it raises to close that attainment gap, is the funding mechanism going to be redistribution formula going to be altered to ensure that, in reality, on the ground, East Renfrewshire Council will get less than the £4 million through its council tax increase because it won't need it to meet the attainment challenge, whereas North Ayrshire, for example, or Glasgow or other deprived areas will get significantly more?
So local government redistribution does look at the needs-based system. All the distribution factors, all the indicators are played into that system. And what the government proposed was a focus around attainment and looking at a very specific way of addressing need. So yes is the answer to the question. It will be based on need. Now that's still subject to discussion with local authorities and others, but that would be done through the revenue support grant, through the grant settlement and through the distribution machinery. But it is needs-based to answer the question.
Thank you very much.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just declare an interest as a serving member of Perth and Connaught Council? Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You have given us an indication of where we stand, and many representatives from local authorities across Scotland are unhappy about the idea that Mr. Simpson has mentioned this morning about national priorities being used. If I can take my own council, for example, the bands that are being suggested, Perth and Connaught would probably have to raise about £22 million from these increases. We would expect, if we are looking at the redistribution, which might be what the government is considering, maybe £6 or £7 million being kept within Perth and Kinross Council, if you're specifically looking at possibly the free school meal usage as an indicator. And I'm not sure if that is being used as an indicator or not. There's a lot of speculation about what might happen and what could happen, depending on where we are here. But what is apparent is that the residents of these locations will assume that the money being raised from their taxes may well be going to support schools within their area, And to an extent, that is taking place. But in an area like mine in Perth and Kinross, it may well not be the case that the majority of the money is being used. And some people may see that as a plundering of the tax revenue that's being raised.
I feel as if we may repeat some of the same issues. I can only say again that that wouldn't be the case because local authorities will keep every penny of council tax raised in their area. But government is entitled, and Parliament is entitled, to look at the multipliers and the council tax proposition. That's why we are debating it today, to then go to Parliament. And government and local government engages around distribution and the revenue support grant and the overall budget settlement, and indeed on the indicators that inform that settlement. And that's the existing infrastructure. And it's through that kind of approach that we would embark on this issue. But I say again, every local authority will keep every penny raised as a consequence of these changes. And the government, through the funds that we've deployed, through the settlement that we deliver to local government, can then discuss and debate how those targeted resources that we are providing will be delivered to each local authority. And we'll try and do it, of course, in partnership with local authorities. And in terms of the methodology around need, it is correct to say it was around free school meals, but we're engaging with the education sector and we'll engage with local government to say, you know, do they have any other suggestions around another way to do it? But that's our proposition in which we'll approach the issue.
Thank you, Kevin.
Final supplementary on this, and then we'll move on to another theme. Elaine Smith.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, in the evidence that we've received over the past few weeks, I don't actually recall that we've received anyone saying, don't do this. But what we have received is evidence around calling it a political fudge or saying that it's less regressive, slightly more progressive, a wee bit fairer, tweaking at the edges. These have been the kind of comments in evidence. So I suppose, given what you said in response to that question, my question would be, the local authorities will raise the extra funding in these bandings. You're telling us they will keep that extra funding, which they will. But given what then happens thereafter, is it a kind of reverse ring fencing? And we've had some evidence that suggests that that is what witnesses would think it is. So you know, you then actually, because you're reducing or intending to reduce funding, then it's similar to ring fencing, but in a kind of reversed way. It's not extra money to provide a government priority. It's less money because they're getting extra money through the way they're raising local taxation.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think that's a helpful question, but I would say that by changing the multipliers, it generates over £100 million through council tax. Local authorities keep that. But government is entitled to readjust our revenue support grant to deliver targeted additionality. And it's that kind of additionality that a number of political parties called for in terms of support for education and specifically around attainment. So local authorities keep the resource and government is entitled to look at the revenue support grant and all the factors within that, which we discuss with local government. Hopefully we'll reach a deal with local government on that in a partnership approach, but it is for government to propose our finance order, our mechanism in Parliament to judge whether it supports that or not. But the multiplier does generate more money for public services.
Okay. Move on now. Ruth Maguire.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. We heard a lot in our evidence sessions of people calling for a revaluation of properties. Can you just expand a bit on the reasons why the government is choosing to not undertake that and maybe speak to some of the practical implications of a revaluation and the costs involved?
So practically, a revaluation, it would take time, it would be costly, it would put extra uncertainty into the system. I think it could result in a shock to many households, that they were unprepared for in terms of what a revaluation could achieve. And I think the Commission also fairly looked at this, and it would also have a rebalancing issue in terms of geography as well and tax take. So I think there's a number of factors at play in terms of a full-scale revaluation. The reason we're embarking on these proposals, and can I say this is not the end of the story in terms of local taxation or council tax for that matter. I had said in the chamber that I want further discussions around what we could do next, but this is certainly, I think, very worthwhile in terms of the steps that we are taking, that we're proposing a balanced approach, one that is more progressive, fairer, it can be delivered at lower administrative cost, and it can be delivered quickly, as early as April next year, whilst generating resources for public service. So I think that we've presented a balanced package to be able to take this forward, but revaluation would be a shock for many. It would have an administrative cost, it would take time to implement, and I don't think it'd be particularly welcome. Indeed, the Commission reported that it would also be very challenging. So we're taking a very balanced approach, giving certainty to income, to local authorities and to taxpayers as well. As I say, a vast majority, as a consequence of these regulations, will not pay more. And of course, there's the issue around the further flexibility for local authorities to be able to raise council tax at their discretion. We've proposed a cap of 3%. However, I think that's a balanced package and set out in a very reasonable way.
Thank you. If we just come back in on the matter of the cap at 3%. Can you speak to why it's 3% and what government will do to ensure that that cap's enforced?
Well, I suppose the capping issue is partly a political judgment around what would be acceptable to the public, what would be in line with inflation. It's hard to judge inflation along with all the economic turbulence and uncertainty, but that was, I suppose, a judgment on what's reasonable for local authorities, what's reasonable to taxpayers, having had in the past quite substantial increases in council tax that certainly wasn't welcomed by the local populace. And there has been a period of a freeze, but I think it's acknowledged that freeze can't continue into the next term. We put a proposition as a party, as a government, to the people, and that was endorsed by the people giving us a mandate from the election on our taxation proposals, and specifically on council tax, a 3% cap felt reasonable. How I approach the matter with local government is to have a partnership approach, and hopefully we can find agreement around that in the way that there has been in the past, and I want to have those discussions in a constructive spirit. But there are existing legislative provisions for government to be able to cap council tax through existing legislation around council tax levels. But I want to embark on it in the partnership approach with local authorities. And I think you'd have to use your own judgment as well. If you thought, you know, do you think that local authorities would put it up beyond 3%? So start off with the partnership approach. But there is legislative provision to cap the council tax if that was required. And on that, I would have to return to Parliament on an authority-by-authority basis, so to use. And of course, I would approach Parliament if that was required.
Thank you, that's all for now, yeah.
Can I ask a brief follow-up question on the revaluation point? Now, this was debated recently in the Parliament as well, and I made the point at the time that if some members were suggesting that, and we'll hear more about this later, if we had a fully progressive system, as the Commission was suggesting, that should perhaps be implemented, but we should also implement revaluation and have the 3% council tax increase as well. And I was looking at some of the numbers around that. So a banned e-property under the Scottish Government proposals will see their council tax up £207 under the Commission proposals by £436. When you get to band H, tax would go up £516 a year, but under the Commission proposals, £3,688 per year, and that's before you look at a potential 3% increase on top of that. If we were then to go to revaluation, then Cabinet Secretary, I do believe we have to do revaluation at some point. I made that clear in the Chamber. If we do go towards revaluation, Do you think we'll be able to take the council tax base with us on the basis that someone in a lower tax band property that's already seeing their council tax increase by £400-£500 a year plus potentially 3% and then moved into a higher tax band property, do you think we'd get buy-in from the council tax base, the families that we all represent across Scotland?
Convener, I think I had covered off some of the administrative points, the shock to the system points. I think you've certainly expressed more of that. If there would be that degree of turbulence, I think there would be an issue about compliance and certainty of payment as well. It'd be so much change at one point, and the difficulties that come along with that would give us, I think, all great concern, because it would be very substantial increases, far more than we are proposing. A lot of turbulence, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of change, at a lot of administrative cost as well. So for all those reasons, that's why we're not convinced by revaluation.
Okay, Kenneth Gibson, do you want to supplementary?
It's only 3% figure, which seems to me arbitrary. I mean, the UK government has set a long-term inflation target at 2%, so I'm not really sure why 3% has been picked. But it goes back to the issue of local democracy. I mean, this is the whole issue that's been raised with us, with our witnesses. Surely it should really be up to local government to decide what their increase, if any, should be, because it's about electing people who will take these local decisions. And lastly on this issue, 3% across the board is not progressive, because it affects everyone equally, if it, or whatever the amount below 3% is. And a lot of people have not, their income isn't increasing by 3% a year, so that will surely hit people perhaps in the lower bands. And if it's going to be a 3% every year increase, which if you're setting a cap is more likely to be than if you just leave it up to local government to decide, surely, then that's going to be increasingly burdensome in the years ahead, and unpick some of the good work done by the council tax freeze.
Well, all I can say is the SNP stood on a manifesto commitment, and that was endorsed by the people to follow this approach. And I think people didn't appreciate in the past significant increases in council tax. And I think that's why there was a view that the council tax freeze was appropriate, fully compensated by the Scottish Government. But of course, it's right. It's time to look at empowering local authorities, and they can make the decisions about how much council tax they charge. The reason we propose the 3% cap is because we feel that that's a reasonable cap, a reasonable limit. And I do think it is Parliament is entitled and government is entitled to set a cap if we have achieved a mandate from the people, which we believe that we have. We weren't the only party at the Scottish Parliament elections that proposed such a cap. So I do believe there's consensus around this particular issue, and a reasonableness approach around ensuring there's not particularly high council tax rises. You know, it wasn't so long ago that a local authority was toying with an 18% council tax rise, and I don't think that that would be particularly welcomed by that local authority. So I think that the government's taken a balanced approach to this issue, protecting household incomes, leveraging in further resources for public services, whilst at the same time making the necessary steps to make the council tax more progressive.
A brief supplementary from Mr. Simpson. I want to move on to Mr. Whiteman, who now wants to explore another theme.
So it's about revaluation. I think your phrase was, if you did it, it would be a shock to the system, which I think means unpopular. There'll be winners and losers. We took evidence to suggest that 60% of households are in the wrong band at the moment. So if you were to revalue, you know, let's say half of those would win and half of those would lose. I just wonder, well, how long do you want to leave it? Because we've got values that are 25 years out of date now. Do you want to go another 25 years?
Well, it's not our proposition to have a revaluation in this term of office. We didn't propose it in March statement. We didn't propose it in the manifesto. What we have outlined is the package of measures that we've proposed. That was endorsed by the people. And I'm interested if the Conservatives now believe that they support a revaluation. I'm not sure if that's now the position of the Conservatives, but it's not the position of the government.
Okay, I think we'll leave that set. You'll have the opportunity within the debate if you want to explore any of that further, Elaine Smith, or you want to come in, and then we will move to Andy Whiteman.
Thanks, Convener. It's just to the Cabinet Secretary has made comments several times about a mandate because of the SNP manifesto. So, Cabinet Secretary, you say you have a mandate, and presumably that's why you didn't consult fully on these changes. And actually, I think if you had, a lot of the evidence that we received would have been explored in the consultation. But I'm just wondering if you really do feel that that is the correct approach, given that you're not a majority government, you are a minority government. So would it not have been better actually just to consult?
I think what we've listened to and reflected upon is the Commission's work and other stakeholders, but then formed a view, yes, as a party and as a government, on what we want to propose. And we believe that the package that we're offering around particularly the multipliers, because that's what we're debating and that's what we're voting on today, of course, is the right thing to do to generate more income, to make council tax fairer through the multiplier effect. And there will be further work on this with local government around, of course, its implementation. But we have to know, the question is the will of Parliament to let this progress, to allow the multiplier to change along the lines that we're suggesting? I suppose that's what will be tested today.
OK, thank you. Can I move to Andy Whiteman?
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for coming along today. I have a constituent whose flat in Edinburgh is in Band E, but which is now worth quite a bit less, £20,000, in fact, less than nearby flats that are in Band B. What should I say to him when you tell Parliament and this committee that your proposals are more progressive, more proportionate and fairer?
Well, I think that they are. I think that the proposals we're putting forward are fair, that a majority of households won't pay any more as a consequence of the multiplier change, and we're trying to protect households from a high council tax increase, which is why we're proposing the 3% cap. And we're also generating more resources for public services, and I think it's a fair and a balanced approach, not delivering the kind of shock to the system that a full-scale revaluation would, or astronomically high council tax increases would for people.
I'll tell him that and see what he...
After you tell him that, do you want a follow-up question, Mr. Whiteman?
My microphone on.
Sorry, right. My apologies. Yes, there
you go. I'll tell him that and see what he takes of it. In the 92 Local Government Finance Act, it was anticipated that there will be revaluations. It was one of the reasons why, at the moment, when someone makes alteration to the property, which has the effect of decreasing or increasing their council tax ban, those changes are not implemented until the property is sold. Those provisions were put in place at the time because it was anticipated there would be revaluations. You say that a revaluation now would be a shock. Can I suggest to you that ignores the fact that there are deferral schemes that have been introduced in Northern Ireland, that Wales had a transition, that even under the 92 Act, you have powers to introduce a revaluation on a timetable of your choosing. And to ask you, when, if not in this Parliament, do you anticipate a revaluation taking place? Or do you anticipate the centenary of 91 values still being used in 75 years' time?
I suspect, Cabinet Secretary, you may not be the Cabinet Secretary in 75 years' time. That said, what are the medium-term plans of the Scottish Government?
Well, I say again, and I don't know if Mr Simpson was saying I might be in 75 years' time, but I suspect not. I think I've made clear that we didn't put forward revaluation in the manifesto or the March statement, so it's not a proposition we're putting forward for this term of office. Having said that, for all the reasons I've given, and I say again, I don't think that the decision today or further decisions around local taxation should end here. I think we should continue to discuss what further improvements we'd want to make, and I make that offer again because I think there are issues we can look at further. I think there are further amendments that we can make, and we should continue to explore that. I described it as a journey in the Chamber, and I meant it. But these are the proposals that we laid out during the course of the election that we're now asking Parliament to support. So we'll embark on these and return to other issues if members want us to do that, to explore it more fully. And, you know, that's in the spirit of consensus and a constructive approach, recognising that, of course, there are issues within all of this that are worthy of further exploration, but it doesn't lead me to the conclusion that a wholesale revaluation is wise or necessary at this time.
Thank you. Just one final question. I welcome your indication that there should be further discussions. You talk a lot about your manifesto and you're implementing your manifesto. In the chamber on the 22nd of September 2016, you say that, "I categorically assure every local authority area that every penny that's raised in council tax will stay in that local authority area. How we propose to allocate revenues towards education is as was proposed in our manifesto, which is through the revenue support grant." Can you point me to the bit of the manifesto that said you would distribute or allocate those revenues through the revenue support grant?
Well, what we're complying with is the desire to raise the extra funding, how we propose to spend resources on education through the attainment fund, by raising council tax, which does stay with the local authorities. It allows us to have a mechanism within the revenue support grant. So the Scottish Parliament manifesto that we produced from the SNP, it didn't actually cover every element of local government distribution. You wouldn't expect it to, because some of that's down to the dialogue with the local government. But that's how we fund local authorities, largely through the revenue support grant or through those finance orders that also come to Parliament around local government finance. So I have been clear that we want to deliver the attainment fund, the increase thereof. We want to see through the multiplier changes. And I'm proposing as Finance Secretary that we can do that as part of the revenue support grant, because there's existing infrastructure and how you determine need and how you distribute resources.
Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned that the statutory instrument's not the end point in the process. And you've said again today, as you said within the debate the other week, that it's a journey in relation to that. So before we move on to the next question, can I just check that as that journey continues forward, what do you see the role of this committee in working collegiately with the Scottish Government to tease out some of the options, including potential suggestions that if we can get unanimity within the committee that might be able to be explored further by the Scottish Government?
Well, clearly I want to deliver the government's manifesto, but we also want to ensure that we can continue to be progressive and reasonable in our approach in light of circumstances. So I think that committee can continue to have discussions, and I'm certainly happy to be engaged in that. But equally, political parties will express to me what their budget asks are, what their view on budget proposals may be, and what they think the future of taxation should look like. And I've said I'm open-minded on this, and I know that the First Minister, in answer to First Minister's question, said she's happy to engage on tax matters as well. So that commitment to engage is certainly there, to listen to views and to take that forward, whilst, of course, what any government would want to do is deliver our manifesto.
I understand that, Cabinet Secretary. A supplementary from Elaine Smith.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you know, it's on revaluation again, but some council taxpayers weren't even born on the dates that their properties are assessed from. I think that point has to be made. And in evidence, we did get a lot of concern about this, and one of the professors who gave us evidence actually said that it really undermines the credibility of the system, where perhaps about 57% of properties are in the wrong band. Now, I accept what you've just said about wasn't in your manifesto to revalue, but back to the point I made earlier, and maybe building on what the conveners just said, given that that it is a minority government, would you at least be open-minded to testing the will of Parliament on whether or not there should be a revaluation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm expressing the government's view that we don't see a revaluation as wise or necessary. I think it'd be costly. I think it'd be disruptive. I think there would be issues around compliance also. A lot of the issues we've discussed this morning, and that's not a proposition we support. I mean, largely the collection rates are high for council tax. We want to build in more progressivity into that to make progress. Of course, separately to this discussion, in the other committee. There's work around the council tax reduction scheme as well. So this feels like the right balanced approach. And revaluation, I think, would bring in so much administrative turmoil and cost and uncertainty and compliance. It would be a concern for the government, and indeed, you know, potentially for local authorities as well, if there was an effect and an impact on their collection rates.
I think I've got Mr. Stewart to take in for another question. He's indicated we'd like to ask before the start of the evidence session. Is it a supplement specifically on revaluation, Mr. Simpson?
No.
Can I take in Mr. Stewart first in that case then?
Thank you, Convener. Many people said, Cabinet Secretary, that the council tax freeze was unsustainable through the length of time that it took. So it may not be a surprise to everyone that we're going to have this change. But in managing that change, how are we planning to ensure that the public awareness campaign is progressive and that people get the opportunity to see and hear before the bill lands on the doormat? And I think it's important that we do have an idea or a flavour of what isn't planned in the run-up to the decisions that are going to be taking place and how people can still engage in that process. Because, as I say, for some it will not be a surprise, but for some it may be a shock.
I think that's a very fair question from Mr. Stewart around the communication of what's decided, and Parliament, through its committee, will determine what's decided, and then, of course, that will go to Parliament. And then there is that communication exercise, which is very important, so that we absolutely raise awareness of this. And I suppose, principally, the bill that people look at, it will be the bill. That will be the piece of correspondence that they look at when their council tax notice comes through the door. So there is a job of work around communicating what's happening around the multiplier so that everyone understands that, how it affects individuals. And of course, crucially, again, not for this committee necessarily, but also the council tax reduction scheme so that people get the relief that they're entitled to as well, and communicate and raise awareness for that. And then what local authorities choose to do around any council tax increase as well. So all of that must be communicated, and communicated direct to householders. Because this is of course, a tax that touches every household in whatever way. So it's really important that we share that information as quickly as possible. But like with the IT companies, the providers, the world of local government, and then householders, clarity will be given, hopefully from today, as to what is likely to happen. And then we can embark on that a campaign.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, a supplementary on this specific point, yes, Mr. Gibson. Okay.
Sending out notifications to everyone to let them know their council tax is going to be increasing bands E to H. For the 74% of people whose council tax banning is not going to increase, are you going to be giving them a letter to let them know that the Scottish Government is not going to be increasing their council tax?
Well, I'm sure that the government will be as positive as possible about our approach, but we'll do this, of course, in dialogue with local government, and ideally it would be good to have a joint piece of communication between Scottish Government and COSLA, of course, on how we share the information to local householders. And can I say, sorry, Convener, but I'm sure political parties will express their own views in approaching council tax bills and indeed the forthcoming local government elections.
I suspect they will, Cabinet Secretary. I think that was a really useful supplementary from Mr. Gibson. My kind of take on last week's evidence session was that whilst everyone wishes the council tax to increase, maybe different mechanisms to make it increase, no one wants to either take the credit or blame, depending on how it wishes to be expressed. And that's the mood music I got from last week's evidence session. So there may be local authorities that don't particularly wish the Scottish Government was doing it this way. There's some support in some areas, not in other areas. Irrespective of that, can you give a commitment that the Scottish Government and COSLA, where possible, irrespective of policy differences, will try to speak with one voice in a coordinated fashion in terms of promoting this tax change to all of our communities?
Of course, Convener, it's really important that whatever the political differences on local taxation, but there is clarity and good, sound information to householders so they know what they're paying and why they're paying it. So I think that's a very reasonable plea, and you know, I believe that COSLA would engage in that constructively, as would Scottish Government.
and neutral information, so 32 local authorities all with their own distribution networks as local authorities at council taxpayers' expense, for example, neutral information would be helpful in relation to explaining the factual position rather than opinions, perhaps.
Well, I think that's right. When it comes down to, and I'm sure we're all familiar with our own council tax bills, it's a pretty dry and straightforward piece of communication, sometimes with accompanying information from different local authorities. But I think that's right. I think that's why it's really important that we try and get a joint communication coming from COSLA and Scottish Government, just to set out the facts, set out the changes, and then taxpayers will understand what they're being asked to pay in good order, in good time, with that level of clarity.
Okay, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I think we're moving towards the end of our question and answering question. Mr. Simpson's indicated he wants to ask another question. Graham Simpson.
Yeah. It's really just for the sake of clarity. We've got figures from Spice about the additional income that will be raised in individual councils. So, for example, City of Edinburgh, 15.6 million, East Renfrewshire, 4 million, and a whole variety. Once you've dealt with grants, and can you say if any individual council would lose more in grants than they'd gain in council tax?
Well, the final figures and distribution hasn't been determined, so I can't honestly explain that at the moment, give those figures as yet.
So it's possible they could?
Well, what I'm saying is what I've said throughout, that local authorities keep every penny in council tax. How you then distribute through the attainment fund is yet to be determined.
Okay. Can I ask one more?
Yes, I'm just conscious of time, but yes, you can ask one more.
Okay. If you were able to identify £100 million from somewhere else, would you be proposing these council tax changes?
I think that's pure speculation, but everyone has said that the council tax freeze is seen to be unsustainable. A lot of householders maybe want it to continue, arguably. Folk have described it as popular. But I think it's necessary to reform the council tax in the way that we are, absolutely. And I also believe it is important to invest in education. I do believe it is important to invest in attainment in the way that, you know, a number of political parties have also described. So I actually think both are necessary.
Okay, and we'll maybe move on from there. I'm conscious it's understandable something that's got such a significant amount of political attention that we've moved towards policy and opinion, and that's reasonable. There's some brass tacks to the statute instrument that perhaps we haven't explored, and just to give you the opportunity to put some of that on the record before we move to a formal debate. And I know Elaine Smith wants to raise one of those points.
Thanks very much, Convener. I actually want to raise two of them, but I'll do it together. I presume that we would expect a higher number of applicants for the council tax reduction scheme. So would there be any attempt to target those people to provide them with adequate information? Could that be included in any national publicity campaign? And secondly, could we have some opinion from you about the, or even some facts about the water and sewerage charges and how that will fit in?
Okay, that's very helpful, Elaine Smith. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, two key points there. First, on information, yes, we can embark on a campaign, but sometimes with generic campaigns, they feel quite meaningless to people, but a bill, an invoice, feels quite meaningful. So I think that's a great opportunity that I'd want to ensure that we build in enough information about the relief schemes and potential eligibility of that, so we get proper uptake. There's about 500,000 recipients of the current council tax reduction scheme. You know, we would expect that, yes, to change. So absolutely a clear focus on information, eligibility, and a general campaign, but very specifically on that communication to every household. That would also be good for current uptake on reductions as well. So I think that's an excellent point. And on water charges, I appreciate the opportunity to provide clarity on this as well. As I understand it, this is a matter between Rosanna Cunningham herself in terms of appropriate Cabinet Secretary responsibility. But the water charges essentially have already been laid out, and we're not proposing to change that this year. We're not proposing to mirror the changes because, you know, there's administrative issues there. But essentially, it's already laid out in terms of the current charging regime and order. So I don't propose to change the water bills following on automatically from this.
Okay.
Okay. Cabinet Secretary, can I thank you for giving evidence to the committee, and that ends agenda item 3. And can I now move to agenda item 4, which is still on the same theme of subordinate legislation. And for this item, the committee will formally consider motion S5M 1522, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the draft council tax substitution of Proportion Scotland Order 2016. The committee will also consider amendment to that motion S5M 1522.1. Only the Cabinet Secretary and members may speak in this debate. So can at this point invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move motion S5M 1522. Cabinet Secretary.
Formally move, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I now move to invite Andy Whiteman to speak to and move amendment S5M 1522.1.
Thank you, Convener. I've tabled this amendment to seek to express the committee's awareness of the wider concerns around the Scottish Government's proposed reforms to the council tax. These concerns are not themselves at issue in the terms of the statutory instrument itself, but they have come through in evidence before this committee, and no doubt we will make reference to them in our forthcoming report on the legislation. The Cabinet Secretary's motion takes the form of a recommendation to Parliament that the draft council tax substitution of Proportion Scotland Order 2016 be approved. Parliament will in due course make its own mind up on that question, but the committee has heard evidence that the context within which this order is being debated is problematic, most particularly the extent to which the Scottish Government's proposals on council tax reform do not address the wide range of issues raised by the Commission on Local Tax Reform in its final report. The evidence we've heard is quite clear, and given the breadth and extent of the evidence and the authority of the witnesses who've given that evidence, deserves, in my view, to be noted in the motion. The amendment does no more than note some key concerns expressed to the committee in oral and written evidence. It does not seek to take a view on the validity of those concerns, or indeed whether, as members of this committee, we agree or disagree with those concerns. It merely notes them, and it recognises a fact of the first recommendation of the Commission on Local Tax Reform. I commend it to members and move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whiteman. Can I now move to the open debate? And I'm in members' hands how long they wish this debate to last for, but can I ask if any members wishes to make a comment during this section of the debate? Elaine Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm pleased that the Convener chose this amendment to be debated today, as put forward by Andy Whiteman, because I really do think it is fair to note the concerns that we have received in evidence over the last few sessions. I think I said earlier in question, and I'm just going to say it again, that much of the evidence that we received did recognise that the order is, and depending on your language, either slightly more progressive, slightly less regressive, a wee bit fairer. And I think that, for me, the fact that the order does allow some a bit of a fairer approach at local level to the council tax has got to be a good thing. There is, of course, concerns around whether the government then uses this sort of reverse ring fencing approach to decide how some of that money is used in a way. But on the other hand, I think personally for me, it's difficult to argue against a government policy that wants to provide funding for attainment and for education. I think that is a good thing. But how we arrive at that has been the subject of some debate over the past few weeks. So personally, having looked at the evidence and considered it all, I'm certainly very happy, and I did sign the amendment, and I think that for the committee, what Parliament does is up to Parliament, but I think for the committee and reflecting the evidence, I would make a plea that other members would support it as amended, because I think that does reflect what we have seen, and it simply notes the evidence. It doesn't take a position on it. Thank you, Convener.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Convener. Frankly, I don't think the amendment adds anything which won't be in our committee report anyway, and I would draw the attention of paragraph 7, where it says the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee determined it did not need to draw the attention of the Parliament to instrument on any grounds within its remit. I think we're really talking about two things. One is the kind of evidence we've taken, and the other one is the instrument itself. And as far as the instrument itself is concerned, it is implementing a manifesto commitment, and it is more progressive. There are issues, of course, which we've discussed in debate this morning and at other meetings regarding the mechanism, and I believe that these issues, revaluation, etc., will all be covered in a report. So I really don't think there's any necessity to support the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. Mr. Simpson?
I would go along with that. I think the main issue we're here to decide is the Cabinet Secretary's proposals. I don't really see that there's much point to this amendment, because that's the key question we're here to decide. So I'll not be supporting the amendment on that basis.
Okay. Does any other member wish to add anything before we move to Ruth? Yes.
Yeah. I would echo Kenneth Gibson's thoughts there, and I'm also a little bit concerned that we've not had a chance as a committee to reflect on the Cabinet Secretary's evidence. So it would feel not quite right to do this before that. And I think that the noting the concerns that have been expressed is valid, but that they should be noted in the committee's report. So I will not be supporting the amendment.
Okay. Would another member wish to come in? Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I'm like-minded with many who have spoken already from the committee. I understand the reason for the amendment, but I do not believe it brings any more value to the process that we have, and that we are here today to primarily look at the proposals by the Cabinet Secretary, and for that reason, I would not support the amendment either.
I would like to make a brief contribution before I move to the summing up from both the mover of the amendment and the Cabinet Secretary. Does any other member wish to add anything before? On either.
The main question. I'm essentially against what's being proposed because it breaks democratic accountability with councils. And I can't get past that. And I speak as someone who's been a councillor. I am a councillor. It's a fundamental change, in my view, to the way local government is funded and local services are being funded. And so for that reason alone, I'll not be supporting the Cabinet Secretary's motion.
Okay, thank you. I might now just make a few remarks, and then we'll move to closing statements. I will be supporting the statute instrument before us today. I can't not recommend to Parliament raising an additional £100 million to tackle the lack of educational attainment from some of our most vulnerable children in some of our most deprived communities. And essentially, for me, that is precisely what we're voting on here today. And I can't find any compelling argument not to vote for that today. I would now like to turn my attention to the amendment. Whilst I won't be supporting the amendment, I actually think Mr. Whiteman's done a service to Parliament, because quite often instruments go through unnoticed, and the procedures of committees go through unnoticed also. I think Mr. Gibson rightly pointed out there is a reporting mechanism that this committee will have, which will actually flesh out a number of the concerns that are noted within the amendment. I suppose anyone watching here today will be very aware of that process now, that the committee will be reporting on this matter, that we will be drawing to Parliament's attention anything we think is appropriate, but we'll have done that after having had a chance to reflect on the entire sum of evidence we've received over a number of weeks, which indeed includes the Cabinet Secretary's responses to us here today. So for that reason, I can't bring myself to support the amendment is before us, but I think it is reasonable to say to anyone watching, as well as to my fellow members, as we seek to draft a hopefully report by consensus, that we will of course draw to the attention of Parliament anything that we think is appropriate. And by not supporting this amendment, actually what I'd be seeking to do is have a much more fleshed out and considered report to Parliament. But I completely understand what Mr Whiteman is trying to achieve here today. Can I just check there's no other contributions from members at this stage? Okay. In that case, can I invite closing comments from Andy Whiteman?
Convener, I've heard what members have said. On the substantive motion, I will not be standing in the way of the statutory instrument passing into law. I am, however, concerned that the full powers of the Local Government Finance Act 1992, the full ministerial powers available under that Act, are not being used, particularly to bring the tax base up to date. I find it unacceptable that in April next year, people will be paying the wrong amount of tax, particularly the kind of person I related to earlier, my constituent. Nevertheless, I continue to commend my amendment to the committee.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Whiteman. Cabinet Secretary, to sum up and to respond to the debate, if you so wish.
Convener, I suppose it can be said in summing up quite whilst you're ahead, and I appreciate the support of members within committee in speaking in favour of the statutory instrument. That is fundamentally what we are debating, whether we're choosing to change multipliers or not to generate more money for public service. And I think that it is the right thing to do. It's a balanced approach. It is one that does protect household incomes, but is more progressive, is fairer, is part of the journey that I described in the Chamber. I do want to engage further with political parties on matters of taxation. And there will be plenty other places, I'm sure, to discuss local government distribution, the budget and other matters as well. So this amendment, the motion, in terms of what has been described, and I'd want to reassure Mr. Simpson that supporting the statutory instrument today doesn't necessarily support any consequential budget discussions. This is about the multipliers. That's what the statutory instrument is fundamentally about. And I know that even the Conservatives had a proposition for raising the bands and the multipliers for the upper bands. So I'm not sure if it's an issue of principle on the multipliers. But fundamentally, I think this is the right approach, and I would appreciate the support of the committee. And I too have heard the concerns and the evidence that has been expressed, and of course we will all reflect upon that.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes the formal debate at this part of our consideration, and we will therefore move to the matter of voting. So the first question is that motion S5M 1552.1, the amendment in the name of Andy Whiteman, which seeks to amend motion S5M 1522 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Constitution, be approved. Are we all agreed? Okay. So we'll now move to a vote. If you are agreed, could you raise your hands, please? Who's agreed? Okay, that's two members. Those who are not agreed, that's five members. So we only have seven members, so there can't be any abstentions at this stage. So that is two for the amendment, five against the amendment, no abstentions. As a result, the amendment is not agreed to. Okay. So we now move to the second question, is that motion S5M 1522, which has not been amended, in the name of Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution, be approved. Are we all agreed? Okay, we are not all agreed. Can I ask those who are agreed to passing motion S5M 1552 unamended to raise their hands, please? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Those who oppose the motion, please raise your hands. 2. Are there any abstentions? And we can record one abstention. Just for clarity, I'll just read that out again. So that's 4 in favour of the motion, 2 against, and 1 abstention. As a result, the motion is agreed to. Okay. Well, that concludes consideration of this particular affirmative instrument, and the committee will consider its report on this SSI, as we've previously discussed, at the next meeting on the 26th of October. We now move to agenda item 5, which is also subordinate legislation. For this item, the committee will formally consider motion S5M1594, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the Draft Council Tax Variation for Unoccupied Dwellings Scotland Amendment Regulation 2016. Only the Minister and committee members may speak during this debate. And can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move motion S5M1594?
Move, convener.
Okay, thank you. Would any member like to contribute to a debate in relation to this particular motion? Okay, no one's indicating that they wish to speak. Can I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to sum up? It says here, and to respond to the debate. I suspect you'll not be doing the latter, but you have the opportunity to sum up.
I think I welcome the consensus. An agreement appears to be agreement on this particular issue, convener, and I'll say no more.
Okay, I'm delighted to hear that, Cabinet Secretary. So the question is that motion S5M1594 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Agreed. Okay. That concludes consideration of this affirmative instrument, and the committee will consider its report on this SSI at its meeting also on the 26th of October. So at this stage, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for attending. Thank you to all of you. Should we wait? I'll just run straight on to this. I think we'll just move on to agenda item 6, which is, we're delighted to hear, still subordinate legislation, committee members. And the committee will consider the following negative instrument: the Acquisition of Land Rate of Interest After Entry Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016 /258. This instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament votes on a motion to annul the instrument. Members will note that there was a breach of the minimum 28-day rule between the date of laying the regulations and the date when the provisions come into force, but the Delegated Powers Committee considered that breach was acceptable in the circumstances, and I note once more that no motion to annul has been laid. Can I invite comments from members in relation to this particular instrument? Okay. There have been no comments in relation to this particular instrument. Can I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Are we agreed? Okay, thank you. Well, agenda item 6 now being conducted, the committee now moves into private session. Thank you.